Hello, my name is Jakob Kihlberg. I'm a researcher at the Department of History of Science and Ideas at Uppsala University in Sweden. Today I'll be talking about public meetings in European illustrated news magazines during the 1840s. As part of an ongoing research project, I'm investigating how images of political meetings in early illustrated news magazines were related to notions of the people as a political force in modern society. I'm especially interested in how the transnational circulation of images could give the elite readership of these magazines a sense of belonging to such a political collective. But to explore this topic, we must first understand how images of political meetings worked in the context of the illustrated magazine. And today I will therefore explore some of the ways in which they functioned. More specifically, I'll consider how they were interpreted and reinterpreted when they were used in different national contexts, as well as how we can understand their visual appeal as images. Before we look at these questions in more detail, I'll start by saying something about the more general context in which they were published. In the early illustrated news magazines, the very notion of a news event, that is something worth documenting in pictures in this case, seems to have been closely tied to the idea of the public gathering of people, that is assemblies of people that participated in collective manifestations or ceremonies. The logic seems to be that if large numbers of people had gathered for some occasion, this must mean that this was a newsworthy event. And conversely, if the news images showed a sizable crowd, this indicated that something of importance had taken place. We can see this phenomenon in many places. We have, for example, innumerable images of crowds celebrating cultural or scientific icons. In this case, the Scottish poet Robert Burns, as well as a never-ending stream of collective festivities and sports events where people are assembled. And other common topics that permitted the depiction of large audiences were the launching of new steamships and opening of railway lines, for example. Yet another common theme in this large category of images was the public dinner, most often involving elite groups, even though the example shown here actually portrays a rather mixed assembly of printers and typesetters. The focus on people assembled as audiences in early news images has of course been noted in earlier research. For example, by Peter Sinema in his well-known research on the illustrated London news, and more recently by the architectural historian Anne Hulsch. But it's worth emphasizing here that images of audiences were everywhere, and also to underline that there's nothing natural or self-evident about the fact that news events were so strongly identified with gatherings like these. Rather, it reflects a particular bourgeois public culture of the 19th century, centered around spectatorship and public performances, and especially oratory performances. Part of this public culture were also political gatherings of different types. A common subject was, for example, the chambers of parliaments and the states in session in different countries, as indicated by the German reuse of a small British wood engraving shown here. Other types of political assembly that were often pictured rather took place in the streets. Examples include the hustings, typical of British election campaigns during this period, also shown here. Another common subject was popular political manifestations in the United States, here represented by two images of crowds outside the home of the Democratic political party in New York. As these examples indicate, many images of participation in politics before 1848 pictured events in the English-speaking world where freedom of assembly was often greater than in continental European countries. Closely related to these political gatherings were also political meetings in a narrower sense that I will now look at a little more closely. These were arranged by political or reform associations and were a specific type of assembly with a well-established meeting format that included an agenda, elected representatives, the voting of resolutions, etc. The first example I will discuss represents the Irish Repeal Association working for an independent Ireland. Shown here is an image first published in the Illustrated London News in 1843. Daniel O'Connell, famous frontman of the repeal movement, occupies the center of the picture, and it portrays him speaking before a large audience at the Corn Exchange in Dublin. The first thing to note is that this image tells the story of public speaking as a mediated event. We see that the gestures and pose of O'Connell indicates that he's speaking, and so does the attitude of the audience. It appears from the way the gazes are organized that O'Connell is addressing the mostly female part of the audience that is seated in a special section to the left. In the middle of the picture, officials of some sort, stenographers perhaps, taking notes, are represented at a long table that stretches back through the hall. Taken together, these features can be interpreted as a way of showing the power of the spoken word. The men taking notes here clearly represent the media system that could make instances of public speaking into transnational news events in print. That this is so is confirmed by the article in the Illustrated London News that focuses strongly on the interest in the international press for what O'Connell said at the meeting. The relation between O'Connell and the female part of the audience can be read as a comment on the speaker's rhetorical skills. And the fact that he specifically appeals to women can be seen as a critique of the emotionality of the repeal discourse. A position often taken by the Illustrated London News. A second noteworthy aspect concerns the description of the image in text. Incorporated are some of the well-known slogans used in the repeal agitation, and they here serve to explain and to frame the action in the image. Furthermore, several of the participants and their role at the meeting are also described in text. Most interestingly, the three figures to the right of O'Connell, the ones slightly elevated from the rest of the crowd. From the article, we learn that they are supposed to be foreigners that have come to listen to the famous champion of national liberation. On closer inspection, we can perhaps see that these men are distinguished by certain specific traits, but that they are there to represent foreign nationalities, more specifically French, German, and Spanish, would hardly be obvious without the explanation in text. When the image was reused in French and German magazines, the even larger role of the textual element was obvious. In the Paris and Leipzig versions, the main characters are pointed out and described, as well as many other things that would not be apparent to local audiences. But there's also room for reinterpretations of what type of event we are actually seeing. If the Illustrated London News underlined that this was a spectacular and emotional meeting, a rather ambivalent rhetorical show, these aspects are clearly downplayed when the image is reused. Instead, it's given other connotations. The freedom of assembly is a very prominent theme in the French article, as it obviously was in France at the time. And the image is here presented more as a general example of a respectable meeting of citizens demonstrating against an oppressive government. In the Illustrirte Zeitung, the image is framed by a general discussion of the right to self-determination for all nationalities that are caught up in outmoded political systems. A take on the picture, of course, closely related to the German situation at the time. My second example of a political meeting confirmed this dependence on both accompanying text and general context for the interpretation. And it also shows how it could change the meaning of the original pictorial statement. In this image, we see according to the caption, a so-called May meeting in Exeter Hall in London. May meetings were gatherings held in the spring each year by a range of British philanthropic associations to mobilize and to propagate their cause. By a magazine like the Illustrirte London News, these meetings were generally described as a welcome sign of progressive developments in society. And the massive audience pictured here can be interpreted as an illustration of the force of this modern popular movement. In this image, we see many of the standard features of how meetings were represented in the illustrated press. It is in many ways more typical than the unusually detailed repeal meeting I showed before. Here, there are no identifiable people performing, instead only a small black shape in the middle of the picture signifying a man with his hand raised addressing the audience. He's shown only from behind and from a distance. And the primary function of this sign seems to be to identify this as an instance of public speaking. The actual substance of the image is rather the impressive hall, its large dimensions, and especially the elaborate coffered ceiling, as well as the large audience seen as a hardly distinguishable collective. This forceful representation of both setting and audience creates an in many ways impressive event, but this does not entail that the meaning is settled. As in the previous example, when the image traveled, it could also be reinterpreted. In the Illustrirte Zeitung, the image was incorporated in a reflection on the advancement of industrial society in Britain and the replacement of old festive traditions by these modern urban happenings. The German magazine gave the image a slightly nostalgic backdrop, but still described the meeting as a phenomenon characteristic of modernity, something that held great promises for the future as it showed the force of organized philanthropy, not only for industrialized Britain, but also for other countries. And thus the use in the Illustrirte Zeitung reinforced the original presentation in the Illustrated London News of this as a promising event. In the French magazine, on the other hand, the essential meaning of the image was changed. L'Illustration used the image in a chronicle of weekly political events, and there described it as a gathering of a Protestant missionary society. The meeting is said to be part of an agitation in London against the French. The context was the so-called Tahiti affair that shook the relations between the two countries during the year 1844. What was promising, the size of the audience, the lively atmosphere, etc., here became menacing. And L'Illustration writes about the fanatical intolerance unleashed by the speakers at this meeting. Here the image changes from a view of civic virtue to one of fanaticism. It also becomes a divisive picture in the sense of a representation of strange forms of foreign behavior rather than something to imitate. This sense is enhanced by the use of the image in a context where the international and colonial relations of France are thematized, here represented by the Egyptian rulers printed on the same page. As these examples indicate, images of political meetings could play important transnational roles in the illustrated press during the period. The significance of such images was closely related to the role of the spoken word in the public culture of the time, and especially how oratory events were reported in print. As we've seen exemplified, the image-text relationship was also fundamental to establish the meaning of the images. A tendency to narrate the image was especially apparent when it traveled, a phenomenon that also made room for often quite radical reinterpretations. These images were clearly pictorial signs that could be used for different purposes in different contexts, for example, through changes in the accompanying text. But at the same time, it's important to stress that they were not empty signifiers, so to speak. They also had a force of their own as images. even though it might be unclear exactly what they represented, that they depicted gatherings of importance was evident from the large crowds of well-dressed people, the impressive architectural settings, and the spacious meeting rooms. Impressions of importance and of spectacle were also conveyed by more formal means. Most importantly, the size of the crowd was a feature that was often evoked by the use of the slightly elevated perspective that has been described as typical for illustrated magazines during this period by the art historian Andrea Korda. This essentially unreal viewpoint, where the observer seems to float somewhere above the heads of the people in the image, permitted the representation of the crowd as a sea of heads, as one of the magazines put it. At the same time, the desire to represent architectural settings and lavish interiors could also pull the composition in another direction. As many of the pictures of public meetings demonstrate, the inclusion of decorated walls, galleries, high windows, and especially the often magnificent ceilings creates a fisheye effect in terms of perspective many times. These compositional means are one of the ways in which the importance of the meetings were established. But to appreciate the force of these images, I think we also have to reinsert them in a diachronic context and recognize that they were closely related to a specific tradition of political iconography. This point is illustrated by my third and last example. Shown here is a representation of the founding meeting in 1846 of the Liberal Party of Belgium. As was typical for imagery meant to commemorate events of this kind, it was both produced as a single sheet print and reproduced as a wood engraving in the press. The image contains an almost overstated reference to a picture that was already at the time a well-known political icon, Jacques-Louis David's Le Sermon du Jeu de Paume, or perhaps rather the reproductions of the studies of that unfinished painting that circulated in the first half of the 19th century. This example is perhaps extreme, since the image is almost over-ambitiously trying to connect a later meeting to one of the founding moments of modern popular politics. As you can see here from the small caricature by French artist Cham, some of the poses used in the image had already by the 1840s become cliché to the point of invoking ridicule. But whether an extreme example or not, I think the general tendency to explicitly or implicitly invoke earlier representations of famous moments of popular politics was widespread, and that it explains much of the interest in images of political meetings. It could be argued that to understand the force of images of meetings, we need to recognize that they evoked a whole tradition of both commemorative and documentary image making, that dealt with political events where crowds of people had gathered to protest, debate, or overturn established institutions from the 18th century revolutions onwards. And this leads me back to where I started and the general question that interests me in my research project, that is how pictorial representations could contribute to the making of the people as a political subject. As the examples have hopefully shown, the audiences that appeared in these wood engravings of political meetings were often, with the help of the means described, framed as representations of the people, a collective that played an ever larger role in modern society, at least in what was perceived as progressive countries. In this way, they could be interpreted as manifestations of the rise of the people in a positive sense. Signs of a civic-minded collective with an important role in government that would eventually develop everywhere and with which elites in other countries could also identify. At the same time, as these examples have also demonstrated, This general tendency to view the people portrayed in these images in a positive light is not self-evident. Not if we consider how, more exactly, individual images were used and reused in specific cases. What was first a promising event with a civic-minded people could be turned into an expression of fanaticism by a change of context and presentation. If we want to understand how these images contributed to a transnational discourse about popular rule, it is thus crucial to realize that they could invite both identification and opposition, and that popular movements could be seen as both hopeful and menacing. As I hope I have shown, it will be important to take this into account, and the examples discussed here have perhaps indicated some of the ways in which such an analysis could be pursued. That was all I had to say. Thank you very much for listening.